Good morning this day and welcome in the name of our Lord Christ. Welcome to this service of worship. How good it is to see you and how glad we are to be together this Labor Day weekend. When we have celebrations of any kind, even if it is Labor Day, it gives us a sense, I think, of our belonging together and the things that we share in our hearts and minds. And so as we all sort of are celebrating this weekend, it is good to be together in worship, where we belong and where that belonging is made evident in the table of blessing, which is prepared for us. Several announcements, as always. First of all, let me remind you of the attendance pad on the inside aisle end of the pew, if you'll pass that along. And we have been asking people to give us their name and address and so forth so that we can, and telephone number, so we can correct our church directory. Lots of phone numbers that are no longer in service and all that kind of stuff in our directory, so please give us that information. And of course, those who are visiting, if you'll give us information, we can get to know you better, which we would like to do. Diane Earle, the pianist, is going to be with us next Sunday at 3 in the afternoon for one of our occasional concerts. We have such a delightful instrument, this new to us, a new grand piano, and that has come to us because of the generosity of the family of Peggy Pack, and it is in her memory that we will have these occasional concerts. Diane Earle is with us, and you can read a little bit more about her in the bulletin today. On Tuesday of this week, we will have our first Parents of Preschoolers conference and coffee, and if you are yourself a parent of preschoolers, or if you'd like to encourage a friend to come. These are parents who are in our preschool, but of course others of that same age are welcome. The Gordoneers will meet this coming Friday at 6 p.m. Did I say the Gordoneers are meeting at 6 p.m.? Yes, I did. And so that's a slight change. We had been meeting at another time, but 6 o'clock on Friday is the time for Gordoneers. We're going to be beginning a confirmation class, and that's for students who are high school age and younger, middle school and senior highs. We kind of do a broad grading for confirmation so that parents and children, when they feel that they're ready, can participate. Hope that if you're one of those people or the parents of someone who would like to be in the confirmation class, it's an opportunity, of course, to learn about the church and about its heritage and history, and to make that very important decision about whether now is the right time for them to join the church. That begins on the 18th at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And finally, Paul Robinson of this congregation died earlier this week. Paul and Joanne, great members of this church for a short period of time. Joanne had been a member as a younger person. Both of them have died within the month, and so Paul, the funeral services for Paul will be at Kirby's Lover's Lane Chapel at 1 p.m. on Tuesday. There is a short visitation prior to that, 1 p.m. Tuesday. God calls us and calls us together. We're grateful for that, for the call is not just on our physical existence, but surely on our lives as spirits as well. And so together, physically, spiritually, let us worship God.
Thank you.
let us rise in spirit and in body and be called to worship. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of whoever brings good news. The Lord has bared a holy arm before all the nations.
Renounce the hold evil has on us. We turn toward God and look for holiness. With hearts ready to be changed and hungry to be forgiven, let us confess our sins using the prayer printed in the order of the worship. Lord, our modern attest, we are a long way from that sweet starry night in Bethlehem when Jesus was born. We are far removed from that dark day at noon when Jesus was crucified. The distance makes us doubt. The habits of modernity make us wonder. We become timid, so timid that the boldness of the gospel is quiet. Our sins are made up less of what we have done than of what we have left undone. Forgive us for our doubts and uncertainties and timidity. Enlarge our hearts and make us eager for your reign in our world. If we are not cut out to be heroes, make us heroic enough to follow Christ the Lord. Amen.
Indeed it is in the name of our Lord Christ that we pray. Amen. We are, most of us, not cut out to be heroes. And yet it is the goodness of God and the purity and holiness of God's Son, Jesus Christ, which comes to us because of faith. friends again this day, hear and believe the good news of the gospel in which you believe, we are forgiven. Forgiven, and it is in that gladness that we turn to one another and greet each other in the name of Christ. Indeed, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
Let us pray. O Lord, whose love is infinite and whose justice is swift, open to us the mysteries of your word. Let us receive what we hear today gratefully and hopefully, securing the faith that is within us. In the name of Christ, amen. Our psaltery reading today is from Psalm 113. Praise the Lord. O sing praises, you that are his servants.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Let the name of the Lord be blessed. From the rising of the sun to its going down.
Let the name of the Lord be praised.
The Lord is exalted over all nations.
His glory is above heaven.
Who can be likened to the Lord our God? Who has his dwelling so high? He raises the lowly from the dust. He gives them a place among the princes. He causes the barren woman to keep house. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
During this month of September, we're trying to address some questions or issues that come from the congregation. Several of you have asked the same sort of question, and that is what keeps the church from addressing social issues and doing so with a stronger voice? That's a good question, and I thought we would try to engage that. The particular text we're about to read from 2 Timothy is one of those that's often used to describe why it is a people, even the people of God, are not able or not willing to engage important issues. Listen then to the word of God as it comes to us from 2 Timothy in the 4th chapter. The Apostle Paul writes, "In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is the judge, who is to judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I solemnly urge you, proclaim the message, be persistent whether the time is favorable or unfavorable, convince, rebuke, and encourage with the most patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not put up with sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they will accommodate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. As for you, always be sober, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully." Amen. We turn also to a gospel reading selected for our theme today. And let us stand together for the reading of the gospel. On the Sabbath, Jesus began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all of this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Simon, and Judas? And are not his sisters with us here?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief." This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. Well, as we begin with this theme suggested to us by members in the congregation, let me ask you a question. How do you imagine the church is different from the Rotary Club, or from the Bar Association, or for that matter, from the Southland Family Swim Club? After all of those organizations do require an active membership. They all of them do good things. They provide meaningful friendships. The Bar Association even has a code of ethics. Well, I think that the difference is this. No one is going to be willing to die for the Rotary Club or for the Southland Swimming Pool. And Jesus, as we know, died for the church. Would you be willing to die for the church? I think not. But consider this. Jesus thought that the community of believers, that is the church, was worth dying for. Is it still worth dying for? Well, we'll get back to that. Recently, I did ask the congregation to suggest sermons for September. I said that it was perfectly okay if you wanted to try to put me on the spot. I guess I should have known some of you would really take that to heart. It hasn't taken me long to realize that I'm a little bit in over my head. But I was challenged with this question: why doesn't the church have a stronger voice in the political and moral and societal issues of this day? Where is our courage? Why can't we fight the good fight with all our might like we used to? we, many of us, remember when the Protestant Reinhold Niebuhr was on the cover of Time magazine. That was 1948. Similarly, our own Presbyterian stated clerk, Eugene Carson Blake, was on the cover of Time in 1961. A preacher, a Protestant preacher at that, Martin Luther King, was on Time's cover in 1957, and he was the magazine's Man of the Year in 1963. Those Protestant Christians were that important that they would be on the cover of the nation's news magazine. And of course, Martin Luther King won the Nobel Prize in 1964. And so it is that the cry goes up from among us for someone else to come along in our modern day. Where have all the Christian heroes gone, we ask? Well, part of the reason, I think, that we struggle as we do and wonder as we do is that nowadays, instead of standing up for disadvantaged workers the way Reinhold Niebuhr did, we settle for largely symbolic boycotts of Taco Bell. Remember that? We don't engage the real roots of prejudice in our nation as Martin Luther King did. Instead, we settle for being outraged at Hobby Lobby. We don't have the same moral vision that perhaps we once had, except when we take that morality from good old Uncle Si on Duck Dynasty. You see, this is activism recast as passivism. And for a lot of us, it doesn't have enough meat. It's not a real substantive thing. We'd like for the church to show a little bit more muscle. We'd like to have a higher cause to back. I think that's the frustration that lies behind your question. Why doesn't the church have a stronger voice? The gospel message was something that the Lord of earth and air was willing to die for. And that astonishes us. In the gospel reading today, Jesus has been healing people. His teaching is wise, the Bible says. He is doing great works, so says the text. But it also says the people took offense at him. Jesus, it seems, was always defying people's expectations. Some wanted him to be a warrior king, but he was the Prince of Peace instead. Some people wanted him to show off and to draw people to him by virtue of his supernatural powers. But Jesus was more driven by divine compassion and not by a desire to popularize his message. We have that great chorus written by John Bell that we've sung a time or two in church. Firstborn of Mary, provocative preacher, itinerant teacher, outsider's choice. Jesus inspires and disarms and confuses whoever he chooses to hear his voice. That turns the question on its side. It might turn your ears inside out too, but it turns the question on its side. That question, why doesn't the church have a stronger voice? Well, that requires that we somehow agree on whose voice we're talking about. Is it yours or my political agenda or social program or moral issue? Or is it really the larger, much larger voice of Jesus Christ? It's interesting that the gospel says that Jesus could do no mighty work in Nazareth. He could do no mighty work because of the people's questioning. But, it says, but he did lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. Well, that counts as a mighty work, doesn't it? Healing a few sick people. What are we supposed to do with that detail in this story? Doesn't it mean that Jesus' ministry goes on? That Jesus' ministry has currency and life, even if the people around Jesus, that's us, even if the people around us don't quite catch on to the message, or maybe we think that Jesus should be about popularizing our own selfish motives a little bit more. Jesus will not be captured, it seems, by our selfishness. Jesus will not serve as a shill for our persevering in old, opinionated, indoctrinated, prejudicial ways. Jesus means to transform us, not leave us the way we are. Will Willimon and Stanley Hauerwas have written, "We don't seem to do too well when we are the dominant majority or when we're invited to have lunch at the White House. We do better instead when we go to our knees, when we admit our faults and exult in the possibility of our forgiveness. We do better when we get ourselves out of the way and find a way to give of ourselves sacrificially, maybe by taking meals around or by stocking the food pantry or maybe just by smiling once in a while or selecting to say the kind word first. It does help, I think, that we take up an offering in church every week. We've talked about before. That offering is in many ways symbolic. It does renew within us a desire to give of ourselves, and it gives us that opportunity regularly on a weekly basis, even if it is just giving a buck in a basket. I know that the question came out of some frustration, even outrage. Why doesn't the church have a stronger voice? We are outraged, aren't we? We're outraged at the fibbery of our politicians. We're outraged at the violence in our world and our communities. When we become familiar with the lives of the poor, we see how impossible their lives really are. Someone, it seems, someone dropped the moral compass and it broke. Well, let us assume that God expects us to do something with that outrage. But here's the tricky part. What we are to do probably isn't another social program or some governmental or church policy. It's not even a sermon that comes from this fine pulpit. What God intends is that we figure out what Jesus was willing to die for. Jesus died for the eternal love of God and to show that love to a waiting world. The truth is that God created this world and God called it good. And it can be good again with God's help. The truth is that forgiveness is possible. We say that so often. Pause for a moment and think about how wonderful that really is, that forgiveness is possible. There's nothing you have to earn. You just live into that forgiveness. The eternal truth is that God loves us. We are God's children. And Jesus died for that. Now, would you die for the church? Honestly? The stakes of what we're talking about are really that important. It is really a matter of life and death, but you are not called to die for the church. Instead, you are called to live for Christ. In a few moments, we'll enjoy the sacrament, the Lord's table, the sacrament that feeds us and fills us up with Christ so that we might live for Him. Take and eat, my friends. It is for you. and thanks be to God this day. Amen. Let us all pray. Lord, what keeps the church from addressing difficult issues? Well, sometimes we do. Guide us, we pray, to find again and always in our hearts and minds and spirits and souls your presence and your power, your goodness, your call upon us to do and to be good. And in a moment when we gather around the table, we do pray, feed that that is within us that makes us good. And these things we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us remain standing. We will be affirming our faith in a slightly different way this day. The hymn, which is numbered 481, is a musical adaptation of the Apostles' Creed, and you'll find it in your hymnal. We do this as a way of really reminding ourselves what it is we're affirming. Sometimes the creeds are words that are so familiar to us that we forget to think about what they mean, and so this will help us as we join together singing hymn 481.
Faith is hope and the assurance in what is not seen. And so we are glad for tangible evidences of faith. Faith gladdens the heart. Faith gives us courage to do what is right. It pulls us toward Christ. It opens new opportunities to us. It calls for our commitment. I'm going to quote from my favorite hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All that I needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness unto me. I think now it's our privilege to show our faithfulness and our commitment to faith. Let us come before God with our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Loving God, we do make this offering as a sign of our desire to give ourselves ever more fully. We thank you for this opportunity, for indeed we do need to consider and reconsider our commitments. Bless us as we do that and give us strength and courage for living in this your world. And all this we pray in the name of our Lord Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people. Let's just keep that between us, all right? Perhaps symbols are appropriate because this is the joyful feast of the people of God, and we do rejoice that God is present to us in this particular way. God feeds us through Jesus Christ, through Christ's own body and blood. We are filled again with the presence of Christ and with the assurance of Christ's goodness, which becomes our own goodness as we seek to live for him in the world. And so, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks and praise to God. And let us pray. Lord, we do take a moment just now to reflect again on your sacrifice for our lives. And we pray that we might find ways in our living to serve you ever more fully and to take your life upon ourselves so that it might be a model for how we are to live. We thank you for this bread which becomes for us your body, that it might feed us, that we might be full of you. And we give thanks for this wine which becomes for us your blood poured out for the forgiveness of our sins. We do pray that you will comfort us by this meal and feed us fully. Give us a fresh notion of your power and goodness. Remind us again and again of your call upon our lives. And all of these things we pray in the name of our Lord Christ. Amen. It was probably an ordinary day in many ways, and yet it was made extraordinary because when Jesus sat at table with his disciples, his friends, after he had given thanks over the meal, he took the bread and broke it, as I do now, ministering in Christ's name. And as he broke it, he said, "Take, eat, this is my body. It is broken for you, for the forgiveness of your sins." And similarly, after supper, our Lord took the cup and said, "This cup is the new promise, the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Indeed, as often as you do this, do it remembering me." Food is sometimes used to comfort, and indeed we find comfort here at this table. Food also, of course, gives us energy, and so it is from this table that we have fresh energy to go out into God's world. And so we celebrate the goodness of God, the presence of God, God's promises made and kept as we gather with our Lord Christ around this table. These are the gifts of God, and they are for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God this day. Amen. on the body of Christ, the bread of heaven for you. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Lord, we go through our ordinary days barely recognizing how extraordinary is your presence, how real is your power. And so we're grateful for these moments of communion, gathering around the Lord's table, as it were, that we might feel especially your presence and your power. We do ask, though, that as we carry with us this holy meal into the world, that we might find ourselves more able to think of you, more willing to be reminded of your grace and goodness, more willing to respond in our own ways to be graceful and good. We thank you for the gift of this congregation, for the enjoyment we have of sharing in faith, for the many, many opportunities and avenues we're given for service. Thank you for the beginning of a new school year and for the opportunities and prospects that that gives for students. We thank you for new members of our college ensemble, and thank you for all that they bring with them to worship. We do pray your blessing on those who are hurting, those who are ill, those who are struggling just now. And we think especially of the families of Paul and Joanne Robinson. We pray that as friends and family prepare for a service of witness of the resurrection for Paul on Tuesday, that indeed we might feel the power of your resurrection around us. We pray also for those who are ill. And especially today, we pray for Wade Kirk Connell, and we pray that as he anticipates a surgery for what seems to be a pancreatic cancer, that that surgery might go easily and well, and that he might be restored quickly to good and normal health. Oh God, we do put our hopes and our trust in you, and we are not disappointed. Bless us to be assured of that and comforted by the promise made and kept in Jesus Christ, and it is in his name we pray together that prayer he has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, on high earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
so the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be